I often feel I have to start off presentations by saying, if you take nothing else away from my talk today, I'm hoping you'll take away this one point, and I hope I make it very clear. Undergraduate student collaborators can do high-level scholarly research if provided with innovative methodologies that bring together traditional disciplinary research methods with critical digital research methods using interdisciplinary and analytic frameworks. So I just want to make clear, because so many of my colleagues in the humanities feel that undergraduates cannot do high-level research, and I'm here to sort of dispel that myth. I want to begin by thanking Erica Farr, head of digital archives at Emory, for inviting me to take part in today's panel on the digital humanities. I'm especially grateful to Dr. Ronald Shuhard for making possible these important conversations concerning pedagogical practices in the digital humanities, especially in undergraduate education. Myself, trained as an architect and urban planning historian, along with several other fields, I'm particularly excited as a scholar, maker, and practitioner in the digital humanities about the kinds of leadership role the American Academy of Arts and Sciences is undertaking, thanks to Dr. Fenton, at this critical moment in the humanities. I want to share this anecdote with you up front. When we first began teaching our second year or sophomore level introduction to digital humanities in the fall of 2012. We had only 9 students in the classroom. In this third year of teaching the course, we now have 29 students working to develop a series of collaborative Scalar-Brook projects, and Anne showed a great example of a Scalar project, using our special collections Jazz Archive to provide insight into issues of urban development in 6 cities across the US. After reviewing my Intro to DH classroom research project, I was reminded that this effort not only demands mastery of the classic research paper, first and secondary sources, archival research, formatting, including footnotes and bibliography, but as a DH exercise, it also incorporates other forms of critical media studies, including music, video, still image, graphic design, and requires at least some familiarity with all of these things. I'm also of the opinion that these DH research tools have a straightforward application into the classroom, into our pedagogies, that, for example, if we were in an English department class examining aspects of the 20th century novel involving lecture or even Socratic inquiry, we can now do something much more complex, not just a research paper that appears online, but a research paper in a platform like Scalar that really can begin to shift and move into understanding a novel's particular translations, perhaps in a standalone film, a video interview with the novel's author, fragments from the musical score of the novel, textual analysis, and we can even, in the English department classroom, begin to bring in other lecturers to provide insight into extradisciplinary research through the use of blogs, wikis, Skype, and even Twitter. And I think we're going to see much more of this kind of work. I think Anne and Jessica are really leading the charge there in that kind of effort, so I look forward to hearing more about their work. Speaking at this panel, I'm also reminded of Patrick Svensson's article in Digital Humanities Quarterly entitled Envisioning the Digital Humanities from 2012. In it, Svensson details the ways in which digital humanities have often become a kind of laboratory for thinking through the current state of pedagogy and future of the humanities as a whole. Svensson draws some important parallels in the growth of digital humanities with the establishment of Asian American studies in the 1980s. Svensson also correctly outlines a series of embedded core values in the digital humanities, including, quote, a predominantly textual orientation and a focus on technology as tool, end of quote, which has in many ways relegated it to 2 primary but powerful intellectual centers at most Research I institutions, in either the English or history departments. That's an important history to understand, particularly when talking about pedagogy, and to acknowledge, especially with the very important work of scholars who have helped to situate the field in 2 very understandable communities of knowledge. For me and scholars like me who've leveraged the expertise and political capital of my peers in the English and history departments to build a home for digital humanities, it's also very clear that in order to remain at the cutting edge of the field would be to situate ourselves squarely in the interdisciplinary fields of Africana, women's and gender studies, and American studies programs as a whole. I can already see the sorts of parallels in some ways to what Svensson has argued in this piece with the radical transformations many of us helped to bring about in the American Academy in the 1980s and 90s, And even well before that, when the margins or the periphery, mostly through area studies or identity studies and through interdisciplinary studies, became standard practice with the founding of these sorts of programs. I'm currently co-directing the Digital Humanities Initiative, an Andrew W. Mellon Foundation-funded project that jump-started digital humanities at Hamilton College. Not your typical place to do digital humanities by any stretch of the imagination, but luckily we were awarded $1.6 million in two grants beginning in 2012 to begin this kind of work. Over the past 5 years, we've raised over $2.4 million in total foundation and institutional support, and also support from the Office of Digital Humanities at the NEH to institutionalize digital scholarship, research, and teaching at Hamilton. DHI is a research and teaching collaboration in which new media and computing technologies are used to promote humanities-based research, scholarship, and teaching, including curriculum development across the liberal arts. The partnership with my colleague Janet Simons from Information Technology Services, who also acts as co-director, was the first between a faculty member and an administrator that cut across multiple units, including the Dean of Faculty, the library, and ITS. We worked to unite faculty research goals and technology and library science resources to build upon Hamilton's significant strengths in teaching and research. We also worked to emphasize the interdisciplinary nature of humanities research and incorporating students as scholarly partners on significant original research projects. In case that point wasn't clear when I started, undergraduate students as significant research collaborators. DHI helps to create and develop a new humanities environment in Hamilton, one where faculty research projects enrich the undergraduate experience through collaborative investigation and already in partnership with scholars and students at other institutions, and I'll talk about one case in particular, really looking at new questions, new methodologies, and new intellectual strategies in the pursuit of understanding and querying our cultural heritage. DHI's technology infrastructure and research support models are designed to be innovative and sustainable. I think some of our conversations over dinner were very much about the question of sustainability as something that we really need to tackle when it comes to the kind of work that we've been doing. This approach reduces the need for regular revamping of static faculty research web pages by creating infrastructure and processes that maintain research outcomes as living web presences accessible for faculty and student collaborative scholarship. To this end, DHI researched best practices in the development and preservation of digital collections and has developed an institutional repository for digital collections developed for its scalability and extreme flexibility in the manner in which objects can be accessed over an expanded period of time. Our collection software also offers flexibility for the creation and maintenance of the relationships between objects and across digital collections. Metadata schema for digital collections are developed in collaboration with faculty research directors and student collaborators to promote the richest possible exploration and discovery for digital scholarship. So we get faculty to dirty their hands with metadata, and we get the students to dirty their hands with metadata, and we love it. So none of these multi-year collaborations would have been possible without two of our core curricular efforts. One, the creation of an undergraduate minor in Cinema and Media Studies, formerly titled Cinema and New Media Studies. We took the new out of Media Studies when we first submitted our grant to the Mellon Foundation. And the second, through our comprehensive undergraduate research program entitled CLASS. CLASS was really an effort to bring together the connections in our Cinema and Media Studies program that removes the confines of the semester to promote deep understanding of digital humanities research within a specific field of interest. In these experiences, students and their faculty advisor become part of a collaborative working team of experts in DHI. CLASS provides students with the skills training in digital literacies through intensive research and scholarship, coupled with two unique internship experiences. In the summer between sophomore and junior years, CLASS offers undergraduate students an intensive professional development experience and provides a comprehensive overview of work in their respective field of interest. Assistance with job placement in a professional field based on their CLASS internship placement and or graduate studies occurs in their final year at Hamilton. Many of these second sort of experiences that remove them from the kind of research experience we develop in the first summer has taken students into Research One DH centers, has taken them into professional fields working with studios in developing different kinds of work. I would say that in my own work in South Africa that has largely looked at the ways in which we might begin to engage with 3D historical reconstructions and in promoting efforts to reclaim social justice narratives of, in the apartheid era would not have been possible had it not been for the work that we've been doing with students. And I will say that much of the work to visualize and create 3D environments has been because of the work we've done with students who are actually building the kinds of models and the kind of work you see here, where we're actually developing a platform where we can embed primary archival materials in a 3D world and recreate essentially scenes from the apartheid era where students can engage with this kind of history, history that's long been lost or erased, particularly in South Africa because of tourism. So it's been very interesting to do that, and I just want to close by saying that for me, digital humanities applications in the classroom hold the prospect of exciting humanistic inquiry. The prospect of 21st century interdisciplinarity may well be made real, and the promise of the so-called Renaissance scholar or the new Renaissance scholar with mastery in many disciplines may become more and more commonplace. And I think we're seeing many of those folks here today. I hope the above discussion has helped to better situate specific developments in DH and using contemporary research and their eventual application in classroom pedagogy. I'm going to close by doing a pitch for our ILIADS program. My co-director would be mad at me if I didn't do this. But this is essentially Hamilton College hosting 23 different schools coming together and bringing research teams to begin to really jumpstart digital humanities projects, both in the classroom and as part of their research. Thank you.